there was a catastrophic incident. Any hope of finding Captain Lyon, Lieutenant Nugent, Warrant Officer Laycock and Corporal Nags alive has been lost.
After a three-day search, the discovery of major pieces of wreckage confirming the worst.
The recovery effort will continue. We'll be bringing our mates home to their families and to their regiments.
Speculation: a major malfunction caused a Taipan MRH90 chopper to crash. It's just the latest incident to plague the 47-strong fleet.
There have been issues with the tail rotor, with the engine, with the door. There have also been questions around the avionics. There have been issues with reliability.
Then PM John Howard purchased the European-made Taipans in 2004 against official advice.
There were some doubts about some elements of the design, but it was believed that those could be overcome and it would be the right capability at the right price for the ADF.
After a string of safety incidents which saw the helicopters grounded at least 9 times in 2021, Scott Morrison announced the choppers would be decommissioned by 2024, 13 years ahead of schedule.
The Taipans weren't meeting their marks. Simple as that.
The Taipan has been a project of concern for the last decade, and I'm just not going to put our people in that position.
And yet we did. In March this year, engine failure caused another Taipan to crash near Jervis Bay. Miraculously, all 10 crew members survived.
There was a significant degree of scrutiny into the decision to put those aircraft back into the air after the Jervis Bay incident. So until we really know what caused this, it's going to be very difficult to create any kind of correlation.
But with so many red flags and safety issues, will authorities ever let the Taipans fly again?
Foremost in our minds in this moment must be the families of these four men. To them, we are so deeply sorry.
Dr Glenn Kolomeitz is a former soldier and aircraft technician who's worked on Black Hawk, Iroquois and Kiowa helicopters and joins us now. Glenn, would you fly in one of these?
Mate, if I was given the option, no, I would not. This aircraft has been a debacle from day one, and I think this tragedy has just proven what many of us suspected for a long time.
Does that therefore mean that they should never fly again?
Absolutely, they should never fly again. And I heard the Minister for Defence today say that they're still working on getting the replacements, the Black Hawks. Regardless of when they get the Black Hawks, they need to ground these Taipans now.
We had one of these go down in Jervis Bay in March. What caused that to crash?
Apparently, it was a loss of power to the main rotors, which we understand was some sort of software issue that we were told publicly had been resolved. But regardless, that issue was only a few months ago. In very similar circumstances now, and this aircraft has had a horrendous history of maintenance problems and serviceability or unserviceability problems, and it's never really been fit for purpose.
So, Glenn, what do you think might have gone wrong in this latest crash?
Mate, it's a catastrophic failure, a mechanical failure of some sort, I'm fairly convinced, but that'll all come out in the course of the investigation. But just to throw on my... I was a coronial police officer involved in investigations into military aircraft crashes, fatalities, and I can say that there's a root causation issue here, which is the defence procurement process. We buy rubbish equipment, and on this occasion, this rubbish equipment has cost a number of lives.
So who do you actually blame for buying such poor equipment?
Well, you know, back then I was defence advisor to Labor in opposition, and I had a meeting with Sikorsky, the manufacturer of the Black Hawk and the Seahawk, and I put a briefing up to Labor in opposition that the MRH90 was a less than ideal acquisition, and the Black Hawk would have been the better buy. As it turned out, the government brought the MRH90, and now we're seeing, since we brought them, we've been seeing the fallout from that decision. So a lot of it lands in the lap of defence, and a lot of it lands in the lap of the government of the day buying this sort of gear.
So in this particular case, I understand John Howard made the decision. He made it against advice. Does politics ever get in the way here? Like, I often think about this when we're building... We decide certain submarines and we're going to build them in a particular place, and that's Australian jobs and so on. Like, that's a jobs policy. I don't know if it's a defence procurement policy. Like, to what extent do you find politics trumps decision-making, or strictly military decision-making on this stuff?
Politics definitely comes into play. Jobs for Australians and, which is a legitimate issue, but not at the expense of us having the best equipment to do the proper job for Australia, and indeed the safest equipment to keep our ADF people well.
So we've just pledged, what is it, $300 billion over 30 years or whatever it is for nuclear power submarines. Is that a good decision?
You know what? there's a lot of politics at play there too, just quietly. And, a lot of it, the initial submarines, I understand, will come from the States, but the subsequent part of the program will be Australian-made. So we'll eventually have two variants of submarine in order to just get the Australian-made, the political issue, the jobs issue, the local manufacturing issue into the decision. So, time will tell, but politics doesn't work well with defence procurement. It's they're not a natural fit.
OK, Glenn, thanks for your time this evening.
Thanks, guys.
Well, it's fairly forthright.
Right.
Isn't it? We might put some of Glenn's comments to the Prime Minister, because Anthony Albanese will be on the show after 7 o'clock. I'll be interested to see what he has to say.
Absolutely. And if this story has affected you, you can always reach out to Open Arms for 24-hour free and confidential support on 1800 011 046.